to Mark chapter 1. And as Paolo was saying earlier, I have my black shirt on, so there we are. But do you know what? I'm not a real Redford, so I'm just going to take this off right now. There we are. Undo that top button. Not that my shirt is too small for me. But I really appreciate the opportunity to go and serve the church and just sharing some thoughts with you. I know William Smith is working today, with it being the bank holiday weekend in Glasgow. So I feel a bit insecure that there's no one to heckle me today as I preach. But Paolo is here. So I'm sure he'll do a great job in just heckling along the way. And last week, Paolo did a great job just as we're looking at the power of Jesus. We looked last week at the power of the authority and the power of compassion of Christ. And again, today we're going to look at the power of Jesus. We'll look at the power of compassion and the power to heal. I should have kept on with it here. There we are. So we're in Mark chapter 1. And if you've got your Bibles open there, we're going to pick up in verse 45. Sorry, verse 40. A man with leprosy came to him and begged him on his knees. If you are willing, you can make me clean. Jesus was indignant. He reached out his hand and touched the man. I am willing, he said. Be clean. Immediately the leprosy left him and he was cleansed. Jesus sent him away at once with a strong warning. See that you don't tell this to anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest and offer the sacrifices that Moses commanded for your cleansing as a testimony to them. Instead, he went out and began to talk freely, spreading the news. As a result, Jesus could no longer enter a town openly, but stayed outside in lonely places. Yet the people still came to him from everywhere. So this man of leprosy, it was a disease of fear. True leprosy was contagious and incurable and left people in a subhuman condition. Patches of the skin would turn pink, then brown, then the skin would become thicker and there would be a loss of skin sensation. The skin would blister and ulcerate. Hands would become like claws. And even toes and fingers could drop off. And even eventually hands and feet. After a number of years, leprosy would bring death. And very often at this time, many skin infections were treated as if they were potentially leprosy. Lepers were deemed unclean. Not ill, but unclean. Something dirty, something of no value, something to have got rid of. There was nothing worse at this time than to be a leper. But this man in this story, he wouldn't always have been a leper. He wasn't born a leper. He would have had two parents who loved him. A mother who would have cradled him in her loving arms. He would have had friends and maybe a job. People would have rejoiced when life went well. And made a fool out of him sometimes when life didn't go so well. He would have had dreams of being somebody. Making a name for himself. Felt important in some way. Because he's a human being and we all like to feel important. But then one day, he discovers He's become a leper. His world has turned upside down. Life will never be the same. Never again will he feel that loving touch of his mother or wife. Never again to be hugged with joy by his friends. Those dreams he once had will never be realized. Now the only thing important in his life is to stay away from people. Instead, he's been banished from society, an outcast, with no other contact with people who are not lepers. In fact, if he did get too close to people, people would throw rocks at them to make sure that they stayed away. The only thing he had to look forward to was death. And that's what we find at the beginning of this passage. But one day, something changed. Somehow, the leper heard about Jesus. He heard, as we read in the previous weeks, about Jesus healing many people. Suddenly, hopelessness turns into hope. And he thinks, just maybe, Jesus can heal me. And somehow he gets to Jesus and begs to be healed. Now the NIV there says in verse 41, it talks about Jesus being indignant. It's interesting because in the footnote it talks about how Jesus was filled with compassion. And I happen to like William Barclay's translation of that verse the most, where we talked about Jesus was moved with pity to the depth of his being. About Jesus just being overwhelmed at the sight of this leper. Jesus saw somebody where everyone else saw nobody. I want to tell you a quick story of a teacher in Detroit, in America. And in her class, she had someone called Stephen Morris. And she had in her class a mouse that was just running around. And so she asked Stephen, because she knew that Stephen had something that no one else had. And that was an amazing pair of ears. And the reason why he had these incredible ears was to go and compensate for his eyes being blind. And Stephen found the mouse in the classroom that no one else could find. And it was the first time in his life that he had no appreciation for who he was, for what he had. And he went on to go and develop that sense of hearing. We don't know him today as Stephen Morris, but we do know him today as Stephen Wonder, the singer. So he just took that little bit of inspiration in his life to become someone special. And that's exactly what Jesus saw in this leper. He didn't see the nobody. He saw the somebody. Jesus saw the man's worth. A worth that no one else saw. I don't always see the value of things myself. I sometimes log on to the website eBay and I will look at stuff on eBay. And I remember a few years ago, my children were very much into the wooden Thomas the Tank Engine engines. Okay, and you can buy these secondhand on eBay. And I would put in my bid. I would see this come up and I would put in my bid. I think that, to me, that is worth about £2.50. But a little wooden tray. Second hand, that little wooden tray with a couple of little wooden wheels on, and it's very small. And I would think, oh, I've got a good chance of getting that. And then I would say, it goes off for about £15. And I'm thinking, that's almost a new price for that thing. How are people willing to pay so much for that? I just don't get how much people are willing to go and pay for stuff sometimes. But you know what? The leper, He himself also had a price tag on him that no one could see. But Jesus could. Jesus could see that price tag. Jesus could see his true worth. See, God's price tag read, worth the price of my son. Those willing to go and die for that leper and for everyone who'd been cast off by society, he is willing to die. And that was the price on him. So Jesus reaches out and he touches the leper. The amazing thing is that Jesus didn't have to go and touch him at all. We see elsewhere in the Bible, in the Gospels, how Jesus heals people in all sorts of different ways. In Luke 17, he heals 10 lepers while they stood at a distance. We read about the centurion servant, where another servant comes to Jesus and just heals him at his word. And he's healed. He's far away. Days of travel away. Jesus didn't have to go and touch the leper. But Jesus touched him to heal him. When a baby is born, it's important that there's skin-to-skin contact with the mother. By just placing a newborn baby onto the mother's chest, the baby is happier. The temperature normalizes. The heart rate of the baby normalizes with that touch, with that skin-to-skin contact. And there's been studies in orphanages. There was one such study conducted in a South American orphanage, where there was 97 children aged 3 months to 3 years. Their basic needs were being met. Their food, their water, their shelter, their clothes, nappies were changed, they got bathed. But they lacked the funds for lots of people to go and care for these children individually. There was very little physical contact outside of those activities. There was little time for a cuddle. And after a few months, many of the children lost their appetite. They weren't sleeping. They became vacant. And after a year, out of those 97, 27 of those children died. Almost a third. And the study showed the root cause of that was a lack of love, a lack of loving touch. Physical touch is one of the so-called five love languages. To touch is to love. And that's exactly what Jesus did. He touched the leper. Jesus himself could have been infected with leprosy through touching him. But Jesus touched him anyway. Jesus infected the leper rather than the leper infecting Jesus. Jesus infected him with the power of love, with the power of healing, and the power of cleansing. He was healed. The nobody became a somebody again. He could feel important again. He was clean. His world was once again turned upside down. He's got his life back. For me, this has been an interesting summer. My wife was diagnosed with cancer at the beginning of the summer. And to go kind of long story short, we go through different things. There was a test that they could do on the tumour. So the tumour was removed, and they could take a new test that they could take and send the tumour away to go and see how likely that the cancer would actually return. And they told us about this test about a month ago. And then 3 weeks ago, they sent the tumour away, and we got results on Wednesday. Wednesday just gone. And there were different ways it could have gone. They said there's three buckets the results could come into. There's the high-risk bucket of there's a strong chance of cancer returning, therefore we strongly recommend you have chemotherapy. There is the low risk bucket of the risks of chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is not without lots of risks. They far away any benefit of giving it. And then there's this medium, big sort of wide range bucket that would be like, well, it's kind of up to you, really. You're not super high risk, and the risks don't necessarily outweigh. And as that time approached, I just found that I just had to prepare myself for the worst of it being high risk. Of all those things that could come with that, you know, the thought of losing my wife and the thought of all these other things going on, and we got the results, and we sat down with the oncologist, and she said to me, she said, "I know you like stats. The result was 22," and I thought, "What does 22 mean?" I couldn't remember where the boundaries of this lay. Exactly. It has been. I spent the last 3 weeks focusing on these three buckets, but I couldn't remember which bucket the 22 fell in. But anyway, it soon became clear. So there was a wide range. What it actually meant was we were in that middle group, but actually only just, which means that my doesn't need chemotherapy, and they're not pushing it towards chemotherapy. Which it was such a relief. It was such a relief, like with the leper who gets his life back. I felt at that time just feeling overwhelmed with emotion of getting my wife back in my life in a great way. We're no longer waiting. We spend months and months waiting for the next appointment, waiting for the next thing to go and occur. And it was gone. Now, obviously, my wife is still going through treatment and different things. So it's not over, but it's not as intrusive as the major treatments now. There was a real healing in my soul that happened. And I'm sure, to a great extent, that happened to that leper. His life was nothing. He became something. And this story is a foreshadow of the cross. Jesus freed the man from slavery, from something that would lead to his death. Now he had to go and show himself to the priest, to go and show himself as clean. But he disobeyed. Now as a result of Jesus doing something good, he could no longer enter towns. And likewise on the cross, Jesus suffered for doing good. He came to earth to do something good, and as a result, he suffered because of other people's disobedience, because of my disobedience to God, because of all of our disobedience to God. It says in Isaiah 53, verse 4, "Surely you took up our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him, and afflicted." Jesus has done the same for us. On the cross, he cleansed us of our sin. Sin which can lead to death. He touches our heart, and we become infected by his love and his compassion. And he's the one who pays for our disobedience. You know, when I was studying the Bible, I remember, in order to become a Christian, I remember one of the things that really struck me was when I looked at what Jesus had done on the cross, and the idea of being cleansed from my sins, the idea of having the slate wiped clean. I felt the power of Jesus in my life. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I can go through life and I remember my life of how I used to be before. Things that I have done wrong, things that I now feel embarrassed by what I've done. Maybe it's how I said something to somebody, or what I did, or a malicious act that I just feel, that was so bad and so wrong. And I look back at those things, and I sometimes think, and I even shake my head physically to almost like, I want that way. And then I remember that actually Jesus already wiped them out, and wiped them out on the cross. So what is our response? Well, I think we can all make someone important in our lives. We all know many people. We can make them important by showing the love of Jesus to them. You may not be able to change the whole world in your life, but through love, you can change somebody's world. And it might get thrown back in your face, but love anyway. Don't let past hurts stop you from loving others in the future. As the Apostle Paul said, let us not grow weary in doing good. C.S. Lewis said this in his book, The Four Loves. To love it all is to be vulnerable. Love anything and your heart will be wrung out and possibly broken. If you want to make sure of keeping it intact, you must give it to no one, not even an animal. Wrap it up. Wrap it carefully, round with hobbies and little luxuries. Avoid all entanglements. Lock it up safe in the casket or coffin of your own selfishness. But in that casket, safe, dark, motionless, airless, it will change. It will not be broken. It will become unbreakable, impenetrable, irredeemable. To love is to be vulnerable. We want sanitized lives, but Jesus calls us to get involved. Not to keep our distance so we don't get infected. Yet we will get hurt and we will get disappointed. So just in conclusion, the world says, don't get involved, you'll only get hurt. It says, do not touch. But then Jesus came and he called us to be different. He called us to be set apart, to be holy. In Romans, Paul says, do not conform to the pattern of this world. Jesus calls us to touch. Amen.